So just for interest, the student to the, a question to the students from Kazan. Do you still have lectures in Kazan in person, or is everything?
We have lectures in person.
Morning. Our federal government will discuss some new coronavirus probably tomorrow. Decided in the parliament. Monday we will have some new regulations and we will see what they decide. Okay, so good morning, everybody. Welcome to another lecture of information theory and coding. Today, we also want to solve some tasks, but before we do this, we briefly repeat what we did last time, and we have one, two more equations that needed to be explained before we get started with some tasks. Okay, so last time, we basically started describing our communication system in this kind of block diagram, morning, where we had the bits that we would like to transmit, maybe coming from a source coder. We encode those, adding redundancy, which will allow us to detect or to correct errors. So here we have the encoded sequence, the code word that we would like to transmit. Then we started by using the most simple channel model that we can think of, this binary symmetric channel. So meaning a bit can either be transmitted correctly or wrong. So one bit here at the input could end up as a one bit at the output, but it could also end up as a zero bit at, with probability of an error being PE. This from Mike Wolf's part. So this means during transmission, errors can occur. So our received sequence can look different from what we actually transmitted. And then the task of the decoder is to find the valid code word from our set of code words that most likely has been transmitted. So we actually came up with a decoding rule for this, using some assumptions that the code words occur with equal probabilities. This is how we started. And then we asked for the probability that we get a decoding error if we assume we transmit one specific code word A. And what's the probability that we decode anything else but A? This means any error that could occur. Okay, and we basically found out that this is the sum over the probabilities that we observe a certain sequence Y if we know that A was transmitted in the case that our code word estimator yields an estimate different. Just reformulated it in a sum of probabilities, and we illustrated this by using an example here with partition code again, where we have the two valid code words here, 000, 111, set of code words. And now the question is, which receive sequences Y will yield estimate being different from what we actually transmitted? So let us assume we transmit 111, transmitted sequence A, and errors could occur at any position of our code word. Thinking again about the binary symmetric channel. So the worst case will be we transmit 111 and we observe 000 at the receiver. So meaning all three bits got hit by this error probability, all three bits were transmitted wrongly. This can happen, the probability is very low. We have an error probability maybe of 10 to the power of minus 3. The probability that all three of these bits get transmitted wrongly would be 10 to the power of minus 3 times 10 to the power of 1 out of a billion cases, this could actually occur. That's the probability. So the second received sequence that could occur would be like a 001. Errors occur, so the first two bits get transmitted wrongly, the second bit, the last bit transmitted correctly. And also for this case, we can provide the probability that this will happen. It's the probability of having two times the wrong transmission and one times the correct transmission, also here with probability PE. And we can continue this for all possible received sequences. But in order to get the probability for a wrong decoded sequence, we are only interested in the red cases, because in the green cases, our decoder will come up with the correct estimate. For example, if we observe a 011 at the receiver, our decoder will say, it's more likely that 111 was transmitted as 000, and it will decide for 111. How it will decide, we derived it last time, will decide based on the minimum Hamming distance. So the decoder will measure the Hamming distance between what it received, 011, and all valid code words. So in our case, distance to 000 is 2. Two bits are different. Distance to 111 is 1, only 1 bit different. So it's more likely that 111 was transmitted. So here, our decoding would work fine. So for the error probability, we consider only the cases where we get this wrong decoded code. This is basically here in this sum notation. We sum over all possible received sequences, probabilities, for the cases where we get a wrong estimate, red cases. And here you basically see the sum over all these probabilities. I could also write this even better. So this cases, transmitted bit, and so on. Doing this for all red cases will give us the probability that we decode something else as we transmit it. Okay, then we extended this by not considering only one specific code word that was transmitted, but allowing all possible code words at the transmitter. And we do this basically by averaging over the possible code words. So this means we always need to consider the probability of occurrence for the specific code word A. And there we basically now consider example, both cases, we would start here with the probability that 000 is transmitted. And then here, the probability of error that we decode anything else but 000. Then next element in the sum, what's the probability that 111 occurs? Goes in here. And then the probability that we decode anything else but 111. So in this equation, we have all possible cases, all code words to be transmitted, and all errors that can occur if we know that this code word was transmitted. This is an extension to all possibly transmitted code words. And this simplified again, as we assume that all code words appear with equal probabilities. And after combining the sums, we ended up with this, yeah, kind of difficult looking sum. But again, if you look at this simple example with the repetition code, it will be also easy to understand this complicated looking sum. And we just reformulated it a little bit. Here we have the probability for a wrong decoding. And this is also the same as 1 minus the probability for correct. Just reformulated this a bit. Yeah, notice the difference. Here we have a not equal. Here we have the equal. So this would be the probability for correct action, correct decoding. 1 minus this probability is again the probability for decoding error. Okay. And our goal was to minimize this code word error probability. And we see in order to minimize this probability, we need to maximize this transition probability as it gets subtracted here. Larger this probabilities will be, the smaller will be this expression. And maximizing this conditional probability means we need to find the A hat that code word estimate A hat such that this transition probability is larger as this conditional probability for all other code words. So this means we need to compare our received sequence with all possibly transmitted code words. We are called B. And we need to, yeah, we could evaluate this conditional probabilities as we did it in our example. For example, the probability that we observe a 001 if a 000 was transmitted would be this probability. The probability to observe a 001 if a 111 is transmitted would be this probability. So notice here we have the PE square. So this probability will be a lot smaller. We need to select our code word estimate such that it has the largest probability from the comparison with all possible code words. We see that this up here is larger. So this means if we observe a 001, we would decide that most likely 000 was transmitted. And from this, it's also easy to see how this conditional probability is actually influenced. So you see, if we get different bits in our code word, we have the transmission error going in there with probability PE. If we have correct bits, they will go in here with 1 minus PE. So the different bits will make this expression small here. So the more different bits, the smaller will be this probability. It's also clear from our engineering point of understanding. So the more different two code words look, the more unlikely that is it to, yeah, mistake them, basically. So from this, basically, we concluded that expressing this decision rule in terms of these conditional probabilities can be also done as expression of the Hamming distances between the code words. Basically, this simplifies to the comparison of Hamming distances. We need to decide for the code word with the lowest Hamming distance as compared to our received sequence. So this, I also illustrated it here. If we receive 001, the two possible code words that can occur are this one, 000, 111. Let's have a look at the Hamming distances. So if this was transmitted, we would have a Hamming distance of one bit different. If this was transmitted, we have a Hamming distance of two, first two bits different. And as we already concluded, of course, it makes sense, or it will have the consequence that if we select this first one, this conditional probability will be larger. So this will turn out to be the best estimate, the maximum transmitted sequence. Pair the Hamming distances with all possible transmitted code words and select the one with the minimum distance. So in our case, distance here, smaller as here, so most likely 000 was transmitted. And this is actually what this equation will tell us. Measure the Hamming distance or the distance between our received sequence and our estimated code word must be smaller or equal than any other Hamming distance for the other code words B. So just basically expressing this decoding process in terms of Hamming distances. And this can be derived in a similar way for the additive white Gaussian noise channel. Just instead of the Hamming distance, we will need to calculate Euclidean distances. But the idea is exactly the same. Just instead of conditional probabilities, we would have to deal here with conditional probability density functions, and we easily express this, for example, for an additive white Gaussian noise channel. On the lecture slides, I did it, but here we can skip this, just the result. Okay, then we came to the point where we had a look on how to measure word error probabilities or bit error probabilities, and there we need to consider several cases. This is why I made here a quite an extensive example where we had our information bits U here, several blocks of information bits that we would like to transmit. I assume here 10 blocks to be transmitted. We encode them, so we add some redundancy. I model a code here with quite little redundancy, so we add just one additional bit here. Here we have our information bits, and then we transmit the sequence. And of course, then we can ask, what's the probability that we receive here anything that looks different from a valid code word? And we notice we can get here wrong words, so word errors, if either already one error occurs in this sequence. But it could also be that all bits are wrong in the sequence. So if we have really bad luck, all these bits could be erroneous after transmission. But still, we assume the other ones would be correctly. We would have only one wrong received word, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bit errors. This could be the maximum. So this means from just observing word error probabilities, we cannot conclude on the bit error probability. We just can make up this bounds, basically. So if we know word error probability or bit error probability can then be between 1 over n times the word error probability, or it can be also the same as the word error. Those are the extreme cases that can occur: word error caused by one wrong bit, or word error by all wrong bits. And there we need to continue a little bit further today. So we want to look at the estimated code words, but we will start there, right? Unless there are some questions to the things that we did last time. I think this was not difficult. Let us continue. So let's have a look at the word error probability. After probability, the estimating a hat, so the most likely transmitted code word sample. This is actually what we transmitted with this additional parity bit here in green. And we have a certain received sequence. Maybe corrupted by error, or let's received. That will depend on the measuring distance of the code. If our code is powerful enough to produce two errors, or if it will fail to produce two errors. If it fails, we will still have wrong bits after the decoding. This is the case that we actually do not like. It will depend. On the minimum Hamming distance. Be corrected. As I want to some error probabilities, I use an example where the errors cannot be correct. So if we assume, for example, our code would have a minimum Hamming distance of 2. So this means we could have a code word within distance 2, so meaning 2 bits different, that is again a valid code word. So this means if 2 errors occur, this one can be again a valid code word, and our decoder would say everything okay, no error. So, e.g., if dhmin will be 2, the decoder will fail act to correct assume this example. So then this could again be a valid code word. Let's use red here because this is the bad case. Valid code word decoding. Actually, it's here, undo encoding, ending up with our just 4 estimated bits. And you see the errors would be still in here. Info. Is that if we get dmin bits wrong in a code word, things will go wrong. Coder has no chance to notice that there is an error during transmission. If we had only, assume we had only 1 wrong bit here at the receiver, maybe our code would be powerful enough to correct this. It would find the correct code word, no bit error. We have less than dmin bits wrong, we have a chance to correct it or to detect it. If dmin bits wrong, things will go wrong for sure. This is what brings us to another approximation on the bit error probability. Yes. Can you speak a bit louder? So the question is here if the decoder can detect the error. Well, in my example, I want it to completely fail. Of course, it would depend now on the specific code that we are using, on the actual Hamming distance. But go back to our example with the repetition code. We have the 000, the 111. Dmin is 3. Assume we transmit 000 and 3 errors occur. We will observe 111 at the receiver, and the decoder will say 111, everything fine, probably 111 was transmitted. It will. So this is basically the same example, just with a different code. Dmin bits wrong, no chance to detect it or to correct. Here's another question. So if we had only 1 transmission error, we could detect it or correct it. Yes, that's correct. Well, but I have to be a little bit careful. If dhmin is only 2, we still would not be able to correct it, as we will see in further derivations. But it will be possible for us to detect. So 1 bit wrong would correspond to, let's make up another simple example, the 4 times repetition code. It has a Hamming distance, a minimum Hamming distance of 4. And now your question corresponds to the question, what do we do if we observe 2 wrong bits at a 4 times repetition code? You detect that something is wrong because, for example, you observe 0110, but what to do with it? Notice it's not a valid code word, but you cannot correct it because you don't know. Do you decide for 000 or 111? But you would have a chance saying it's not a valid code word. Let's ask for a retransmission. For example, you could do something like this. So also in these cases, you could come up with schemes to, at the end, correct this type of error. Okay, this brings us to the last approximation that we would like to introduce here. So we can say the bit error probability is approximately the min over k. Notice we have here k information bits. It's the word error. Need some additional remark here. This is a good approximation for codes having low redundancy. Good approximation. For codes. Little redundancy. This is the bit error probability. After decoding. If you look at this example, also this remark should become clear why this only works well for codes with little redundancy. Just imagine we only append one green bit here, but maybe 10 green bits for error detection. Then it would be also likely that some of the wrong bits would be inside this green parity bits. And after decoding, maybe we would not have two wrong bits here, but maybe only one wrong bit because the other ones were in the. But for codes with little redundancy, it's likely that if we have two errors here in the received words, that this will also translate into two errors of our information bits. This is constrained approximation. Okay. Yes. Yes. So also for the Kasansuns, there was a good question. So we hardly didn't speak at all about the decoding. We just said we decode based on the minimum Hamming distance. And the question was, if we do not use the parity bits for the decoding. And of course, this is a good question. So making the decoding just based on the Hamming distance, this is like the brute force approach for the decoding. Just imagine you have a set containing a million valid code words. Then decoding, maximum likelihood decoding based on the minimum Hamming distance means you take your received sequence, measure, calculate Hamming distance to a million different code words and decide for the one which is most close to it. And of course, this is not a practical approach. So we will get to know other decoding schemes where we use the method how we determined the parity bits for a more efficient decode to avoid this comparison with like a million different code words. This will come later, how to do coding in a smart way. Okay, some more. Oh, we have a question from Mr. What can mean by little redundancy in terms of number here in good approximation. Okay, so here the question is good approximation for codes with little redundancy. So this means that we only have a low number of these green redundant bits that I've drawn here as compared to the information bits that we would like to transmit. For example, if we had 4 parity bits, because a more powerful code then, and 4 information bits, and there would be the probability that if we have 2 errors during transmission, that one of the errors will be also inside the parity bits. And if we decode this, it could be that we see here only one wrong bit because the other one just influenced the parity bit. So the larger the number of redundant bits is here, the worse will be this approximation, because the min errors in this estimated word A hat can yield a lower number of wrongly decoded bits. With little redundancy, it's likely 2 errors here that we will also have 2 wrong information bits. Otherwise, we would overestimate slightly. Probably we could also write here a smaller or equal, but typically it's written like. Okay, more questions related to. Explain. I want to have a look at the additive white Gaussian noise channel, transmission over the additive white Gaussian noise channel, and there we also want to solve a task related to this. But before we do this, I want to tell you a little bit something about the energies, the energy per bit. You know this from Mike Wolff's lecture. Now we have encoded bits, we have to distinguish energies, energies per information bit, energy per coded bit. To make this clear, show you some relationships between the bit energies. So comparison. It's not comparison, it's not comparison of considering additive Gaussian noise channel. And for simplicity, we use again our repetition code G using a 3,1 repetition code. So assume we have bits to be transmitted. Here would be the bit duration. The information bits. This results directly from bit rate. If you have like 1 megabit per second that we transmit, it would be 1 microsecond bit duration. And we have a certain energy per bit, and to make this correctly, we need here a square root EB or EB. Just recall, because we get the energy of such a wave by squaring signal and integrating. So if we square it, we get EB over TB. Integrate the square, we get multiplied with TB. So the integral over the square will be EB. This is, for example, a transmitted bit energy. we want to encode this using our partition code. Because if we would like to remain the data rate, we need to make our coded bits shorter. We need still to transmit this information within TB. But if we want to implement such kind of repetition code, transmit 3 bits instead. This bit would be TC, duration of the coded bits. Assuming the amplitude did not change. And we could of course calculate the energy per coded bit, but it's very easy to see that it will just 1/3 of the energy per bit. EC. G. Bit. Yeah, well, and it's kind of easy to see energy per coded bit is 1/3. It's the energy per bit. Or in general, we see the code rate here. C, is R, is E. Some more relationships that I want to describe here, but they are very easy to see. Of course, you see the bit duration will be R times B, so we have 1/3 of the bit duration. We could also express it in bit rates. Bit rate of the coded bits is then 1/R, so 3 times bit rate. Bit rate, coded bits. One more important relationship, we already derived the relationship between the energies. So this means our signal to noise ratio, EC to 0 for the coded bits is also reduced because EC is reduced, so it's R times 0. So there's less energy in the coded bits, giving us a worse signal to noise ratio. Ratio. Actually, I want to use a slide to show you the effects of this signal, reduced signal to noise ratio. But we actually also draw it, so you have it in your slides. So So if we would basically look now at the bit error probability B, and here the signal to noise ratio B over N zero, typically we use a logarithmic scale here, decibel. PB typically also on a logarithmic scale, -6, -4, -2, and so on. We get typically here this kind of waterfall shaped curves going down. Start here. See. Well, let's start with an uncoded case, so just transmitting bits. About 8 dB signal to noise ratio, we are at 4. This would be an uncoded transmission. So no protection at all for our transmission. Is now with coding scheme 7,4 code example. So we will calculate this kind of curves. So containing 4 information bits. Code word length of 7, Hamming code. This is a specific code. It's a bit more smart as the repetition code. This is quite an important diagram also for understanding. Let's look at this at a low signal to noise ratio. Here, for example, this 4 dB, so quite a weak signal. There you see actually the bit error probability for the uncoded transmission will be less as the bit error probability when we use this kind of simple block code. Obviously, it would not be smart to use a block code. It would be better to transmit uncoded data. Just as the signal-to-noise ratio increases, we start to benefit this coding scheme. Notice here, for the same signal-to-noise ratio, we now start to get the lower bit error probability for our encoded case as compared to the uncoded transmission. And now briefly think about what's the reason for this. So the reason for this is the reduced energy per coded bit. So due to this reduction in energy, because the coded bits are more sensitive to noise as the uncoded bits because they contain less energy. So typically I explain this again with the example repetition code. You write 3 times what I write on the board. As you write so quickly, you have less energy per letter that you write. So it's more likely that you make mistakes if you write quickly. And in this case, basically, this would correspond to the case you write so quickly that you make more errors as can be corrected by your 3 times repetition code. So this means things get worse as if you would just write everything one times, having more time writing, more energy per letter. So actually here, we suffer from the fact that we have this reduced energy per coded bit, worse signal-to-noise ratio, which will produce a lot of errors, more errors, as can be corrected by our scheme. In this range, high signal-to-noise ratio, we might have only single errors in a code word, and our Hamming code will be able to correct those. So this is why we start to benefit here from this coding scheme at higher signal-to-noise ratios. Low signal-to-noise ratios, many errors inside one code word, our code will fail and come up with wrongly decoded words. So it's always a question of the signal-to-noise ratio we have in mind and the code that we are using. So I used here the Hamming code instead of the repetition code, because actually if we would simulate or calculate this for the repetition code, you will see that at no point repetition code will be better as the uncoded transmission. So it will actually buff this uncoded curve. If we would use a soft decision decoding, as we will see later on for this repetition code, it will lie directly on this uncoded transmission. So that's the reason why you will see actually no communication system where a repetition code will be. So there's no use of it due to the fact that the energy per coded is reduced. But we will get this in more detail. Actually, this is where I want slide the corresponding one. So here you see this more nice pointer here. Yeah, I plotted this performance curves bit error probability using the assumption that we came up with the uncoded case, so just transmitting bits without any coding scheme, blue curve. If we do some hard decision decoding, this would just correspond to determining Hamming distances. So there you see basically what we have drawn also on this curve, where we suffer here in this range from the reduced energy per coded bit. And here we, in this range, we benefit from the fact that this Hamming code will be able to correct single errors inside these words of length 7. And yes, in the next steps, actually, we want to calculate these possible gains that we can get from applying different decoding methods. And we actually can derive that given these parameters of this Hamming code, we will gain approximately 0.6 dB signal to noise. This means we could reduce, for example, our transmit power slightly while still achieving the same performance. So this would be a bad. Okay, but we will come back to this when we out the theoretical equation of bit error problem. Okay, do you have some questions related to this diagram, effects, explain. Yes, one question. A very nice question. So there was the question from the audience, if there's think, or if this is a specific point, not where the curves cross, because this would be a nice task for the students to calculate the point where we actually start to benefit from such a coding scheme. Yeah, well, we could actually calculate this point, but for different coding schemes, this will be at different positions. So this depends on the minimum Hamming distance of this code. It will depend on the length of the code words and the number of information bits. It would be a nice task to calculate. Maybe we can make up ask for the task collection. Okay. There's one question from San. What are these hard and soft decision gains? Kindly explain them explicitly. Yes, we will talk about this hard decision coding gain and soft decision coding gain in more detail. We actually want to derive those. So they describe basically what's the gain in signal-to-noise ratio for high signal-to-noise ratios. So you see at the beginning, these curves somehow intersect. They have a different slope, but for high signal-to-noise ratios, the slope will be more and more like parallel. So also if we look at 25 dB signal-to-noise ratio, we will see approximately the same distance here. And of course, this is interesting to calculate what is the difference in signal-to-noise ratio if we assume the same bit error problem. For example, I can say, reach a bit error probability of 10 to the power of minus 8. Maybe I need this for my application. In the uncoded case, I would need a signal-to-noise ratio of 12 dB. If I implemented this Hamming code, already a signal-to-noise ratio of about 11.5 dB would save half a dB transmit power and still achieve this desired bit error problem. And our further task will be actually to calculate this asymptotic code. So for example, what will be the gain from using a 25,16 gross parity check code? So we would just get an equation where we put in the parameters of our code and we would get a number. What can we gain from implementing this code? But the answer to your question is we will derive this in detail. But the meaning is, what's the benefit of applying a coding scheme and a certain decoding method, hard decision decoding versus soft decision decoding? Also, we have not talked about the soft decision decoding, but we will do this. Okay, some more questions. Yes, yes. So let me repeat the question for the Kazan students. So there was the question, if we add more and more redundant bits, so we increase the bit rate even further, where's the limit of this? Back, it's this one here. So adding more redundancy means here the duration of the coded bits gets smaller and smaller. As we have seen before, the bandwidth will increase. So typically the limit that you will face as design engineer for a communication system will be the bandwidth that you have available for your transmission. So there are for all radio systems that you know, there are so-called spectrum masks where the system is allowed to operate. For example, if you want to develop a wireless LAN device, so there are regulations which part of the spectrum can be used, what's the bandwidth of a channel. So these are usually parameters that are given by the standards that are defined. And of course, the thing that you could modify, you could say, let's use the whole bandwidth of a wireless LAN channel, maybe 10 megahertz or 20 megahertz even, and come up with a transmission only 1 kilobit per second information bits. So very low data rate. And then you notice you could afford really a lot of redundancy until you reach this limit of 10 or 20 megabits. So you could implement a very safe transmission with a low bit rate, or you could implement a transmission with a high bit rate, maybe a multimedia application, something, but then you cannot afford as many redundant bits as before, because you will reach the spectral limit. Exactly. The trade-off is between bandwidth and bits. Yes, so for the hard decision case, we will also see this in detail. We basically receive values. We come up with one decision boundary. We say if it's above, it's a one. If it's below, it's a zero. And we can do this more smart in the soft decision case, but we will see. Yes, so here's again the question from Russia. The meaning between hard decision and soft decision is not clear. Yes, but we will talk about this in detail. Don't worry. So far, it's not a problem if it's not so clear. Yes, one more question. A bit louder. Yes, so here was the question, if it was understood correctly, to achieve a lower bit error probability, we will need more signal-to-noise ratio. Yes. Yes, here's the question about how this graph is obtained. We will derive this equation. Yeah, I just wanted to give you an idea on what is happening if we include redundant bits. We will get this reduced bit duration. We will get this reduced energy per coded bit. And this is actually the effect that we will observe, that the low SNR region suffer this reduced energy per coded. And we will derive equations to describe this. We will relax a little bit by solving some tasks. Actually, I have a task question, but not so many tasks included there. But I think I should also put this on the web example. Yes, here basically in chapter 3, I start with some tasks related to the block codes. This actually also contains tasks for Mike Wolf's part. This is Mike Wolf's business this semester. So we will start here with chapter 3. Block codes, and we start with quite a simple one where we want to briefly review the properties of this code. For example, if this set of code words are sets from a linear. This out of the way, I will write task actually on the board. Ask. It's actually in this collection 3.1. Determine whether the following codes are linear. The following codes linear. We don't worry where the code words come from or how they are calculated. We just assume we know sets of code words and we want to answer the question. This is a linear set of code words. 000, first code word. 100, 010, 001, B. head of code points 000, 110, as the question from San, is the PDF? Not yet, but I will upload it together with an exam, as I promised you last time. It's just very busy since Tuesday. Discussion is keeping me busy. And the last set of code words looking at this. Another question, if the solutions are also available. Yeah, I have to admit that the task collection does not contain a solution, but we will solve most of the tasks here in Glass. You will get a sample exam where the solution is included. For the exams, I can provide you some tasks including a solution, so you can try it on your own and then look at the solution if you can solve it correctly. Okay, now it's time for you to try to verify this. Remember linear codes, it means any linear combination of code words needs to be another valid code word. If this is not true, it's not a linear set of code words. Give you a couple of minutes, try to figure this out. And linear functions, you need to modulo 2 space sums without carry. So from the Russian students. So start to solve it. For the first one, already notice if, for example, I add really the first one and the second one, I will get a 100, which is not a member of the set of code words. Already from the sum of these two guys, I can tell this is not linear code. E.g., we could verify this by 000, 100, this is 100, some more answers here from the students from Kazan. So B, just look at this one. we see something here. Oh, wait, actually, my explanation here is wrong. Shame. Of course, 100 is a member of the set, so let's use another one. Let's use. Use this one here. Probably you all noticed. I just want to see if you noticed this. So for B, let's have a look at this one to make a good example here. If I add the second and the third one at a 101, which is not zero and 01. 01. And for the last one, yes. So no matter which two code words you select here, the result, the linear combination, will be again a member of the set of code words. Combinations. Result. In member. Was just to review just this linearity. Next one, disk 2.0. So in this task, we want to consider general repetition code, consider. N, 1 repetition code. And again, we want to review some basics. Ask A, provide a general expression for the code rate. Very easy, general expression. For the code rate R. Task B. Is it a systematic code? I only want you to view this basic problems. Is the code linear? Is it linear? B. What's the minimum Hamming distance? E, the errors can be detected. And finally, F, any errors can be corrected. All this will be like a function of n, the length of our function code. Again, some time for you guys. Think about these tasks, these questions. students in Kazan just write done in the chat window. Solve all the tasks already. Here for the students, I can guess. One seems to have. Start solution. So not so the general expression for the code rate. So the code rate was the number of information bits that we would like to transmit divided by the code rate, length of the code. This gives us an idea on amount of redundancy that we basically invest. We have one information bit, and the length for n comma one repetition code will be n. It's mit n bits for one information bit. Is the code systematic? Yes. Example, if we want to transmit single bit encode. So we see our bit here as a part of the encoded sequence directly included in. Is the code linear? Yes. We get only two possible code words. We get either the 000 code word. And we see the linear combination of both will be again the 111 code word, which will be a valid code word. Zero times the 111 code word will be the all zero code word. This is the most simple set of linear. What's the minimum Hamming distance? H min. Well, of course, also in a general form, if you repeat the bit n times, the code words will be different in n positions. So distance will be n. And we have not talked about the last two questions in detail. Maybe we start with task F first. How many bit errors can be corrected. Excuse guys. N minus one, you say? Ah, okay, yes, yes. This comes more close. So here the answer was N divided by 2 is 1. Let's see if this can be. Assume the 3,1 repetition code. Obviously, we can correct single errors. 3 divided by 2 will be 1.5, minus 1 will be 0.5. This looks somehow strange. So you probably, or I misunderstood. We do it this way. N minus 1/2. So for the 3,1 repetition code, it will be 2 divided by 2 will be 1. One error can be corrected. For the 5,1 repetition code, 5 minus 1 is 4 divided by 2. We correct 2 errors in a 5 times repetition. Right here in general. What about the 4,1 repetition code? How many errors could be correct? Yes, exactly. Also, only one error could be corrected. So if we introduce a 4 here, 4 minus 1 is 3 divided by 2 is 1.5. So also in this case, this equation does not really help us or provide us a correct description. General, more precise. We will use T, this quantity will be N minus 1 divided by 2 and the floor of it. So rounding it to the lowest integer. Floor of function. This can be. In task E, how many errors can be detected? Well, we can detect anything that looks different from a valid code word. So also for the 5 times repetition code, if 4 errors will occur, we still see what we receive is something else, but not a valid code word. But we can always detect, just here we N minus 1, yes. N minus 1 is detected. Yes, here we have the question from Kasan. How we got the N minus 1/2? Could you explain again, please? Yes. So this N minus 1/2 is basically just from imagination. If we imagine this repetition code, imagine we transmit every bit like 3 times, most simple example. If one error occurs, we will observe more ones than zeros. We will make the correct decision. Single errors can be corrected with the 3 times repetition code. And the single error actually can be expressed in the number repetitions here. 3. We need to subtract 1 and divide by 2 to get to the result 1, this 1 bit that can be correct. Extending this to the next case, 5 times repetition code. If you write everything 5 times that I'm telling you, you could correct 2 errors for the one specific letter of one transmission. 5 times repetition code, 5 minus 1 is 4, divided by 2 is 2. errors. And just driving this a bit further to the n times repetition code, of course, we can conclude that for an n times repetition code, we can correct n minus 1/2 errors. If we would also allow the repetition codes with an even number of bits, we need this floor operation, because as we explained, for example, the 4 times repetition code would also only correct single errors. Because with 2 errors in the 4 times repetition code, we could not safely decide on a 0 or... Yes, one question here. Just the proposal that this can be also written differently. I didn't really understand how you would like to write it. Ah, okay. Here the proposal is, let me briefly think about this. If it can be also written as n divided by 2, the floor of it minus 1. Yes, sure. N by 2 is 1. Ah, ceiling. So if this also works. So for the 3 times repetition code, this will be 3 divided by 2, 1.5, minus 1 is 0.5, the ceiling is 1. Would work in this case. For the 4 times, it's 4 divided by 2, it's 2, minus 1, it's 1, ceiling is 1. So works. And obviously, it will also work for 5 and n and so on. Excellent. I have not seen this version, but it's true. So express it this way. Smart student solution. Yes, correct. Okay, are there more questions related to this? Ah, okay. Yes, the question about the error detection. Why can n minus 1 errors be detected? Again, imagine the repetition code. Let's use the 5 times repetition code. If we transmit a 0, 0, 0, 5 times 0, and we receive a 0, 4 times 0, and a single 1, of course, we notice it's not the 5 times 0, it's not the 5 times 1, so what we receive is something wrong, an error must have happened. So we detect that something is wrong with our received sequence. Yes. And the more extreme case, for example, if n errors occur, we will observe a valid code word at receive. So we transmit 5 zeros, we observe 5 ones. So again, no chance for the decoder to figure out that anything went wrong. So with n errors, it will fail. For n minus 1 errors, it could come up with a strategy like asking for a retransmission, for example. If we apply our decoder for the n minus 1 error case, of course, it will come up with a wrong estimate. If I transmit 5 times the 0, I receive 4 times 1, 1 times 0, my decoder will decide for a 1 and will fail. But we could detect that something went wrong, and we could ask for retransmission. Okay, so we have a question here. You mean is even then in half can be detected, and the min is two can be corrected. Yes, of course we could make up equations for the different cases if n is even or not, and if n is even, the min minus two errors to be corrected will be true. This will be okay, but the errors that can be detected will still be n minus one. Detect anything that is different in one bit as what we transmitted. Yes, and here we have another proposal. If it's odd or n is odd, I assume, then d min minus one half errors can be correct. Yes, yes. So if we distinguish the two cases, even or odd, we could also come up with two equations describing the number of that can. With this floor or ceiling operation, we can basically include this in one equation, both cases, n even. Okay, some more questions related. Sure if I understood it correctly, but so there was a question related to the Hamming distance. So of course, if we think about other coding schemes, we will find out that this will not depend on n here, but it will depend on the minimum Hamming distance. So how similar are the code words, the most similar code words? And then we will see that we can correct dh min minus one half. So in general, this number of bits to be corrected will depend on minimum Hamming distance. Just in our special case here, the minimum Hamming distance is equivalent to the length of the code words. So again, Hassan, the comment. Yes, what wrote from Kasan is correct. So if we distinguish between the even and odd case, we can of course also express it in terms of d min minus one half. Yes, that's exactly and very good. What you okay. Okay, so then I think we are done for today. We will continue next time with some more tasks. I have one more single parity check code and a cross parity check code, some more practical, simple methods, and we will see how these ones work. Okay. I'd like to thank you for your attention, and we meet again on Tuesday. Yes, so have a good time. See you. Goodbye.